continue on that study in the book of Revelation. Now, up to this point, it's been pretty obvious that we've been taking some sort of, the sort of jumping off of the things I said, we just approach to it. In fact, so we spent a lot of time looking at that first page in the context of the inquiry and understanding what was going on there, and hopefully getting to see some real interesting aspects of this, what Jesus said, which is so much more than we tend to just see when we look at the deep disciples and the moment that's the matter. Today we're going to move on to the next episode. All of all, I'm probably going to have to spend a couple of Sundays on the Friday and then today. But since it's cheeseburger day, I'll probably have to have it. But Friday and today, because it's a couple of things that we need to understand. So we're going to move to the next one for the first time, talk about that, and we're going to focus in on one particular aspect that John starts to address those that he's writing to the left. Here's what's happening. So there's really nothing a lot of why we read it just to the first words of Jesus, which John quoted the first day. He just didn't say that there. He just put them in there because he wanted to set off on the conflict. Starting in verse 9, we sort of start to count to the sort of the flow of the letter is coming. And what we're going to see between verse 9 and couple of the first half. Was the basis, the foundation for the letter as Paul. He knows where he did his book of Revelation, as he did on the Jesus. So when we look at this, this is where it actually starts. The rest of this is led up to this point. So I want to bring you to that one verse, giving you the best of this message before you go, because we took a lot of time. I want you to really sit and understand what's going on here, because it makes so much more sense. And you'll see as we do that, why you've heard me say that really with people that just want to do a book of Revelation, the reason they do that is because they don't understand what it's about. That's not what we're not seeing is that the book of Revelation is unique. It's unparalleled. And it's specifically designed not to bring us to that's all it does. It really keeps me busy, and that's why I keep it. So here we go. John Revelation, chapter 1, starting verse 5. Now, John, as I said, starting to sort of introduce the letter. We know in the last day, now, first day, I am the Alpha and the Omega. We now know that the wisdom said I am the Father, which the wisdom said, demonstrated that he was, that's entirely that particular statement. And it just really talks out when he talks about him. Is, was, and is to come. So this verse immediately follows that statement. That's the significance of verse 6. Because John is laying the groundwork for everything that's going to come after the book. And that means everything is based on that verse 7, that verse 8. So here's what John says. I know many of us are familiar with this, but we're going to take some time to look at it again from a slightly different perspective. And we're going to keep our focus on where we're going to be headed with this letter, which I will be. So I, John, both your brother and companion in the tribulation and the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was on the island that is called Patmos, for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. So he begins off, or begins here, stating who he is. He wants us to know that it's John. Now there are other critics out there that are even the commentators who doubt whether or not this is John the Apostle, because he doesn't say, I, John the Apostle, which is absurd. Really needs a guy for us to figure out who this is. But it's amazing when you get into these things and you start looking, especially at those who want to criticize, analyze, terrify, break down, destroy what is actually taught. You have to add to that. So it's a different angle because if you take it for what it says, it's bringing that down. So you got to destroy it. So the question is, what we always do is to talk and talk. Really, there's no proof. It's like, we know from historical aspects who this God was, and that this actually happened. Because what he says there is obviously Christ, but God identifies himself as the brother of the man who is the king. And this is just like, to be the man who is the apostle John, as we're
who is being moved, and we're going to see that's been moved on, who is specifically told that he's supposed to write these things to record these things so that you and I can start making the speech from 2016. That's why it's important. Now, I intended it is your apostles, but even if it isn't some fun, what's the big deal? I mean, just because of that, but the authority of John's apostles is all over the world. So, we have to talk about that. But notice what he says, I want to partner and I can manage the tribulation and the kingdom in the face of Jesus Christ. In other words, I know where you're at, because that's exactly where I am. And what we learn is we read the book of Revelation, you understand the first century, the church in the first century, we have since said. What you understand is the church, unlike today, was under incredible persecution. I mean, we're talking things that you and I getting hit back. This is the period of time that Nero was taken to believe was men, women, and children, and rolling them in tar and putting them on their sleep craft, stakes at night, and finding them on fire by plowing and hitting his chariot. It's the same period of time where they were taking families, entire families, entire congregations, and forced to be all in, be the one. This is historical fact. We don't have any concept of what that is like to compare it to. In fact, that is taking place as a whole. So these people sure did. Maybe I don't want to know this. It's an incredible group of small boxes of martyrs. And you need to read them. Because the life of saints is on every page of the scripture that we're now studying, how do you understand? I will put these people in. But no matter what the world does through its emperor, whether it's Nero or Caligula, whether it's the Mini or whoever it is, Diocletian, all of the Roman emperors that were so just hostile to the church, but no matter what they did, they could not snuff it out. Because the church, every time you try to step on the fire that's the church, you just spread over everything that's going to be your fault. You think that Lucifer would be smart enough to say, you know what, I have to stop persecuting these people. Because every time they do, the church knows. It's amazing. And we're talking about this in verse 30 of Wednesday night in Exodus. And we're at that portion now where, as Travis said, we've heard about Moses being set up in the room that we're talking about how this is clearly by God's design because his parents saw that he was something special. They knew something God was at work here. And this was the first thing that God himself. And the words of the little basket here is the exact same that he used for Noah's Ark. And he just put it in a passage, a wicked passage, and picked up the altar. They built a ark that's the exact same word. And they put it in there and let it float and get down there for the reason that just so happened the princes of Egypt happened to come down to the whole kingdom. And that's what it was. Seriously, man? Because the reason that this was happened is because a Pharaoh had come to rule who did not know that this was. And they were multiplying so quickly. God was so blessing his people so quickly, so rapidly, that they were becoming a threat to Pharaoh and the army. His people are more than we are. And if they hook up with somebody else, then we're going to be in huge amounts of trouble. So Pharaoh did not notice that the way to stop this, they were all from themselves. But I'm trying to show you the persecution of God's people. This is a freedom of religion. This is nothing new, and there's nothing new for us today. And he says, so here's what we're going to do. So he tells the midwives that are going to put the babies there in Egypt. And the never it's a baby, if it's a male, they're supposed to kill them. This is just because this is Pharaoh that's saying that. And later on, if you read it from the Bible, when God brings judgment on the nation of Israel and takes the first word of law, which is, of course, the final thing called grace, it's actually judgment is God's teaching. So I understand those 10 plagues are not great stuff. They're God saying, your God of the Nile isn't God. Your God of the frogs and the elephants isn't God. Your God of the earth isn't God. Your God of the flies isn't God. Your God of the sun isn't God. And your God of life isn't God. That's why his leaders and advisors said to Pharaoh and said, at the point where the custom being wise, they said, Moses is God, he is God. That to come to see when he's making prayer. But he got up and he said, "Tell Pharaoh, he thought he was God." So these guys were teach. But the point is, the fear had gone so much, everybody wants to ridicule about who the God of the Bible is. So he's short of all of the first ones. But it was not about Pharaoh saying, "The true law of sin." In the rich, the purpose of do not understand. The midwife said, "Your honor, what are you so big for? Well, we hear God, but we hear Pharaoh." So they did. Pharaoh says, "Hey, what's going on? It's actually the best. What's up?" Well, the Israelites are not one of us. I'm Egyptian. I'm the They call these things like laws. And like that, they just continue to dig it apart. Before we can even get there to do anything, their coordinates popped up. We can't do anything about it. So then you know what Pharaoh does? He gets to command all of Egypt to throw their children into the Nile. To all of Egypt. You get that? So if you were an Egyptian and you saw a Jew with a male child, you were to take that child under the authority of Pharaoh himself and throw that child into the river. Yeah, God's force. When you say, we're talking to these days, so this is amazing. So there has been persecution against the people of God from the get-go. Even further back, when you go to Cain and Abel, what happened to Cain and Abel? The first murder report was human history. We all know that. They both were going to bring a sacrifice to God, and at some point, Cain had determined he was no longer going to do it God's way. He's going to do it his way. That's how it's defined by the religion, but it doesn't take sense. I want God on my front, and he will accept me. And God said, "God." That's what happened. David came to Christ for redemption of the Bible. All of the things that's been in years, according to the desire. He continued to break up the game. It's close enough. I was marked. God understands that. God loves me. I love my heart. So I'm bringing it for his heart. And he brings it. So I'm his heart. And God said, "I'm not going to see it." I felt myself a little sense of what it takes to be a part of this. It's a sacrifice. It's a sacrifice. It's not your sin. That's it. Is up to being religion, and is up to being redemption. And the two cannot exist. Make sure that you understand. Religion creates redemption. Because death says all you must do is believe. You must trust in the sacrifice provided for you. We know what that sacrifice is. The whole time. It takes time to see the world. Why is it all the time? It's a sacrifice. The religion cannot accept it. Right? We're all talking to this. Religion says, "Oh no, no, it doesn't work. You have to be our folks. You have to sing our songs. You have to listen to our leaders. This is what pleases us. It's a religion. It's a religion." So religion always goes out. Always comes out. Always. Because it's supposed to be religion is the type of cause of peace and God. Eventually, it's never God begins. That's what happens. So this persecution of the believers is not the thing of God's people. It starts from here to here. But it's being right outside. I'm going to be removed from the presence of God. There's a present there. Okay, so. Then Sean says, "Look on your brother and on your head." In other words, we're in this together. And most of them are in tribulations. We're in this really tough time. And again, we don't have a concept of this. We've never had a social concept before. It's the thing that the lightest is to be a little bit more now. Plus 300 girls, Christian girls, the morning. How can that possibly be false? It's happening every day. This persecution that's stopping God is not going to be reasonable. It's not going to be. And it's not going to change. It has been for a while. And Paul got to Timothy. And you know, this body of Christ is in so close. He said, well, you might suffer. So why do we think that the world is going to accept us, that America is going to consider our teachers or our science before all the people that have always left us to the age of the so be open. Stop fraudulence. Stop even whining about that. Don't be left to heaven. That should not be sin. Stop sinning. You're out of debt. So this concept of tribulation persecution is nothing. You're going to have tribulation in this life, folks. It's going to happen. We just don't understand it because we're Americans. We need freedom of this police to happen. But that's what's going on. Are you brother and your companion most because of the kingdom of patience of Jesus Christ? It takes patience to endure this tribulation. In spite of popularity. It's just the way it is. And you and I have a responsibility to do this. Your responsibility is to teach these truths to your children, not mine. That's your responsibility. It's not just people who practice the class, it's just the difference between the people who practice the class. So we have to do it. They love this crazy. So they figure it's well for their patriotic. But it's a deceit. It is not our responsibility. It says your responsibility. Make no mistake about you. You have some respect for your father. Your responsibility is not your occupation. Your retirement or anything else that you might have done in this life. I was not interested in those things, but he is interested in what you will pass your children. You know what? So it will be their responsibility to pass it on to theirs. And he calls every single one of us for what we do as parents and as husbands. So we don't think something that you have to do with this world now. This is what has happened to the church. Embrace the force of culture and all the other stuff that goes along with it. Because, well, you know, I mean, we've been in the sense of God. And that's so crazy. That is the same. Yesterday, and isn't there this thing we teach about God being immutable, which means God's not changed? He's carried 26 feet. His standards are his standards. And there's true about that. That's why he told the people to this. When you go home, you talk about this. When you get up, you talk about this. When you eat, you talk about it. When you go out of the door, you talk about it. Keep yourself mindful. That's the final step. But on your continued path in the tribulation of the kingdom of patience of Christ, this is true of the outmost what's happening out of the time and years of all the death. We won't get into all of this new life, but it's also the hell of an honor that all my people were dead. You didn't deserve death. They put you on this island. They basically break your heart. This is a certain sin. That's what it is. And John, the apostle, sent their brother Peter to the gates. So this was no big deal. And that's what he tells. He tells me, I was on, not to bring kids. That was called. Why is he here? Well, we just said, for the word of God, the testimony of Jesus Christ. I am on this place in this position because of my testimony. And I believe I'm a Christian. That's what he said. That's what he's doing. That's why he said, look, I told you this is the situation because he's going to be dead. And then, you know exactly what he's talking about. That's what I like. I'm so tired. Well, some of you are very much embarrassed. Well, some of you are very tired. with the truth. God said the testimony of Jesus Christ, the gospel. Remember, it's just in Jesus, because after that, you can't receive the truth. Now, don't we understand how much God loves them that He would do this for them? Now, let's be honest, we don't have the time either for what to do with stuff. We do. We're afraid of parts of it yourself in the mirror with no other truth. What you are, we might not be able to split up the truth. Tribulation, persecution, versus wrath. You really need to understand, because there's a massive change that takes place in the sixth chapter. Huge. We're going to see that the big words be wrath, this concept of wrath, that's going to show up in the sixth chapter. So we need to understand what's going on and not mix the two and what was being said. So this word tribulation is this word in the Greek. You pronounce that as lipsis. That literally what the word means is to be under pressure or to be under trouble or affliction. That's the word tribulation. So in Matthew 24, when Jesus said there's going to be great tribulation, such as never been before, what he's talking about is this. So we need to understand that. That's why he's going to say, I don't like to call that the tribulation. So I don't like to do it for the very reason. Because that's not what meant. The whole period of what we call tribulation is something that we figure out how to do. Don't worry about that. But for here, we want to try to set the stage and understand the significance and the difference of the concepts between the two concepts, tribulation, persecution, this wrath, and the peace, and the fury, fierceness of that effort. We're going to see that they are not both as the common new person for them. So it means pressure, trouble, or affliction. The idea is that of pressing grapes. You know, take a bunch of grapes and stuff to make wine. Is that when you throw it in a bath and it comes under pressure and you drop it before you put it up and you put so much pressure on it that it's crushed? That's what we're talking about. That's what happens. But notice this statement. It is always in the context of man's man. It is in this frame. Always. It's when somebody is doing to put pressure or affliction or trouble on other people, whether it's individual to individual, whether it's nation to nation, whatever it is. So that's the thing that you need to do. The concept of tribulation. And Paul said, look, it's got to be tribulation. It's not that Jesus said, the first one is tribulation. It's not to be the producer of this particular one. Is there a lot of others? But there's another concept that I want to do. Now, this is the concept of wrath. Now, let me say this before we move on to the John 10. When you read the Bible, the English language, oftentimes you see a single word in English that literally translates multiple words to either the Hebrew or the Greek. That's why I feel that the English is so significant. God said this many times. No. Many of you know this, but for those of you that don't understand, and you have one word, for example, is the word love. And we see it repeated in different sections of the Bible, John. But even in the teaching of Jesus, when God says love, well, that's something. But John said that God is love. So, and then, you know, we talk about love, brethren, God is love, love, whatever. So we see the single English word. But what we fail to understand is that's not necessarily what the Greek is saying. For example, Jesus on the beach, the deal, after the resurrection. Peter, do you love him? Peter said, Lord, you know, see, that's the Greek, the English is different. My lesson is to read my own, because he's a different. Now, there's probably a part of that. That's not the Greek, that's not the Greek. And then, you know, Peter, do you love him? Peter, do you love him? Of course, you know what he loves. Well, then you know what people see. Peter, do you love me? Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. And then people say, but it's what you want to say. But it's three, that's two different three words that are used here that translate the meaning of love. That doesn't take care of you. One of them, the most important thing to do is the word agape. It means unconditional, intentional sacrifice of affection towards God. This is the kind of love that God has for us. His love for us, his affection, his rewards us. Unconditional, sacrificial, unconditional. He does not love us because we deserve to be loved. He loves us with intention. He's chosen to love us. He's obvious. He loves us sacrificially because he loves us enough to give us life by giving up his. So agape is a pretty significant word, which, by the way, is what Paul says, husbands and mothers. Go on. That means to love us unconditionally and sacrificially. You see, about it or not, it's your own. And the world gets this advice that we're doing about. What do you say about salvation? That's what happens. I'm thinking about the vision of the world. I'm focusing on the world. I think we have to, because we understand the principle. I suppose it's not even that. And then you wonder why the portion of this has this. And then, sure, you know about the world. So, agape is this real stuff. But there's a new level to this. Are they all? Must people fill their life in hell? Be not in stuff or affection. But, well, not in love. You know, the one who gets it. That's the concept. So, it's an affection that you have towards another person. But it does not reach the level of love. Because it's not affection. It's an affection towards another person. But the third thing in the Greek is eros. That is sexual desire. So there's three things that are all defined as eros love. Now let's go back to the meaning of Jesus' conversation with the angels. here's what Jesus said. Peter, do you not think about this? Jesus does. So my point is, when you see these words, persecution, tribulation, wrath, what you need to understand is you're seeing the English translation of the original word. And oftentimes, it's the wrath of the words of the go on the same verse and say that again, and it looks like the same word. That's not it. That's completely different word. So man, this is something to look at the difference in this video. This for himself out, that's what's happening. And most of the things you see at the end of this chapter, they just want to put up lights. They have to put it after the church. You have to just think that everything he's got is going to happen. He knows what's happening. It's the laws of the spiritual stuff. He's working out for the person. He's going to test what he has. So he works through the world and pieces that come out of this. And that's what's going on. So when the dragon that first is pretty old enemy there. When the dragon saw that he just cast to you that word cast, but it just made you believe. So it means stop, quiet, that's our body slam. And you have seen that stuff. He shocked you, fools you, and it's up to the earth. It's much more than just cast. He's cast to the earth. But when that happened, persecuted them, what is that? They go full on after. They go after the woman. Why? Because she came first. They don't have to take her. They get one. This is their classic procedure. That's what's going on. That means about it. Big thing. So that was persecuted. This is the other. As I would put it, now this is different. Because it means to cause fear to some. In other words, if you're scaring somebody out, that they're beating you to death. That's what causes a persecution. So, what is this? Tribulation means to be pressed, whereas persecution means to be chased, to run off or whatever, and being pursued. Notice this is always in the context of the physical. Even though Lucifer is the one the spiritual being is doing, how is he doing? Physical means through the other nations. Right? We're going to get to all that. Sometimes it's developed all now, but that's important that you understand. so you can see that both of these are both, he says, horizontal in their nature. They're not set and done. Up to one of them is to another. This is what it is amazing. And then all of a sudden, this turns up and shows up as a confession. This is what it's done. We know about the gospel. We talk about the gospel of God. We really understand the gospel of God. We understand what would motivate God with his love, as John told us, to get to the point where he pours forth his wrath. What the cause could cause? What could cause that kind of a God who has done everything he possibly can, who has left his heart open for any and all to come to repentance? What would cause him to affirm saying that is enough? We see little bits and pieces of it, but we've never seen on a global scale. That's what I'm about to see. Everything shifted from the top down to the last 3 things in the national region. There's now this new effective income. It's no longer on this scale. So the first part of the book here is in the 6th chapter, the first time. And it shows up here, and what's going on, and what it shows up with, is it shows up within the first judgment of God upon us, which we call the seven seals. And seals the prophet from the seven. This is now the 6th seal. So what I want you to notice is who's identified the master. That's the key. Something has changed at this point. There has been all of this that's been cleared. In the world, whether it's accepted or not, it's relevant. Understands God's wrath is the one that talks to the Lord, that talks to the Son, morally for a long time. By the way, there's times when the wise of God's people for their always and every single one. Every time. Where you see God's wrath, you do not see his people. He's taken it out. Every single one. It's a consistent theme from the scripture. Now, notice, here's the leaders in all of the world have experienced the first 5 of the seals. They are not the only ones. That is how we know it doesn't happen to them. Because what's happened to them is described. They both have been done local or not regional. Chapter 6, he is on a global scale. There is no history that supports what we're about to see in this chapter. Once before. And all of the other stuff we're doing is to build a bridge to that. Once we get there, we just so these guys have been shaking their fists in the face of God, and then God will always continue to do so, regardless of what the evidence suggests. He doesn't care. In our study, we look at that point that God's naked to watch your blessings. I want to bring in and you're going to watch it talk about that point. I want to bring in this big video. I want to watch it. It's called Cats. Here's case 1. There are people out there that are talking pastors. You know what I say? That's what I'm talking about. I don't care about the people that are talking about the course. But I do want us to say that. Those people who reason for a joke and snap. Just tell them the truth. Those people. You're not supposed to do that. The man just wanted to grab these people by the purpose. They're teaching God's word to God's people. That puts it in all the perspective. But anyway, they're out there. And the Exodus has been repeatedly now, for the last roughly 50, 60 years, has been attacked. It's not been attacked because it's part of all of the sources. If you know anything at all, you know that technical ministry itself is everything. But what happens in Egypt, you know, there's not any evidence of all of this dysfunction of Egypt is left in the Egyptians. But there is. It's everybody. But they deny it. I think we're talking about it. You know why? Because it's the problem. The basis of the gospel. We see this phrase in the scripture that talks about Ramses. It's all the Bible is directed to the So there's evidence that suggests all of these things are just parsons and plus the flesh of plus three or four times to give all the strength to find out. They have a place there that's called Jews were not beneath the archaeologists. And yet they tell me this place which was fancy by the way, the world's principal athletes. And guess what happens? We mess up a memory of this. Not without the memory of us so participants. The earth with the things he is, with the revelation, they know full well what's happening somewhere. And they know where it's coming. And you know what they do? We're sorry, God. We return to you, God. We'll put you back in our schools and let our children play. Let's check the narratives back in the justice system. It's out of this time. They shake their fist in his face. And they hate him. See, that's all we can do. But Christians do not listen. What you say? See, God is not the same. That's how it's going to be. It's not the same. So, all of this is happening, and these people now have to provide this. So, the Lord can just watch the control of the Holy Spirit. As soon as they have seen this, they love their reputation. And there's the worst of the four that just didn't have to move from these. The fact that all of these gods, the Jesus, princes, kings, the merchants, all their offers on the mountain, and they said to the mountains of God's followers, turn to the gods, turn to the mountains of God. So look, follow us, and behind us, as we protect us, as we pursue the sun, they want to watch. So follow us and hide us from the face of who? Him who sits on the throne. They know precisely what is just happening. And notice what they said. And it's from the wrath of the Lamb. Who's wrath? The Lamb. Well, that's what the Lamb wants to say. Yeah. They know exactly where this is coming from. This is coming from God. It's coming from the Lord Jesus Christ, God, clearly, it's not the as of God. The wrath is originating from him. Why? Because the world has gone after his people and continues to do so. But all starts from the Lord Jesus Christ. So I said, why are you fighting this? Lord, aren't you seeing the person who was called for the name of Jesus? Now, to you, these are the laws of the Lord. Who is he persecuting that he's seen the Christian name? Good people. Aren't you, religion, persecuted for the deed? Where have you been at? Yes, it's a lot of people. Of course it is. So follow us. From the face of him who sits on the throne, from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of his wrath has come. Not as the Father dreams of God saying, the day he is visited, perhaps the city of God has seen, for the great day of his wrath has come. And who is able to stand? They even know they're not going to make it through this. But notice the few words back. So first one is part of the city. This is rage, indignation, anger, vengeance. And the part that really ties all this together, it ties into the first that he said, this is the one that really is the part of the essence. It burns within God with a burning passion for what's happening. What has happened before? All these people that brought out these people. That's what's happened. That's what has brought all this off. It is an intent. You watch out. God is. So this violent passion is upon these people are doing this. And it's people. Either that love to know we sing about it all the time, or we can hear stuff like this. When we talk about it, God is absent. Jealous. Is incredible. Do you understand what that means? If you were a husband holding out that violent passion for your wife, but she's hurt, or whatever the case may be, the meaning to God. It's that thing that's burning in you for someone else that you love. Offer yourself a bride to do less for this. You ask the part of family. See a whole different side. Why? Because there's a violent passion inside. You're stopping. God doesn't want to bring it into your house and have a test. Come in there, take your life, bring in your family. I don't know what would happen to you. They don't know what would happen to you. It's happening before. You lose power. That's what you can't release yourself. To protect that person. Right? That's the first thing you need to do. I said to you. Even today, I saw the other one preach about firm hearts to deal with them. This is a guy that told that he just laid a phone head. Oh, I'm like, you cannot be serious. That's what I'm talking about. It's a good thing. So, this rap, Oregon, that's what it's talking about. We're talking dangerous. That is motivated by what is in the heart of God, his people. He gets to punish his people because of all of them. He is the discipline. He can be even great if we know repeatedly from Scripture the wrong direction it takes. Because they're just people. And he often looks like a parent who is probably some kind of be doing this to the children. He can do it because it's motivated by God. But it's that same love and the same action for the love of the ones he loves that causes him to be so violent towards those who we are his people. Do you understand that God and Jesus himself are pictured as warriors? Well, we always see Jesus on the cross and you see him as self-sacrifice. But tell me that doesn't mean that you're on your heart sick. God is on by force. When you're all geared up, then you come storming. How does the force come out of everybody? Just give it to you. So, because this violent passion is just the Lord, he loves me to stand up with me. There is a fight for me. Why can I not stand up for me? Because that's your problem. point of the seals is what? Wrath. Where is it coming from? The angels? No, they're just the messengers delivering the message. They're coming from the wrath who's sitting on the throne, who in the last chapter was given the scroll that has these seals on. It's coming from him. That's the view we need to take of revelation. Something about the church of Israel and the Gentiles. It's not about them. It's about God and his final passion. And it's those who are those who would suppress the people that he loves. That's what he gives himself. It's just this is one more person. God is flesh. We're all dependent. Here is the possession of the Christian. Here's the careful rejoice of God. And here's the God. So, that is much more than just talking. for finding things to show you the truth. So as you read these truths, looking at all of the other scripture that you have from, all of the writings of the show that this is not the cause of the revelation to anyone, but the culmination of all of this receiving. So if we need to understand, we're really going to understand that and stop listening. Whatever question comes to you, I want to take you back to the picture and show you the heart. God's wrath and his tribulation is to be present. Thank you.